Chocolate squares make up the base. Couple of handfuls of crushed pretzels. Top it all off with marshmallows. And...
Whoa!
Voila! Teddy Brulee.
Finally, arson and food together.
Hey, Teddy, can I play with that blowtorch? I just want to inspect it, you know, learn about it.
Yeah, sure. Here you go.
Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to Binging with Babish, where this week we're taking a look at Teddy Brulee, thanks to a sponsorship from Skillshare, an online learning community for creators with more than 25,000 classes in design, business, and more. There are more than 7 million creators learning with Skillshare. In fact, it's where I learned how to make the marshmallows that we're going to make today. But for the literal recreation, we're going to stick with the store-bought stuff. First, we have to source our largest torch-resistant bowl, build up a robust foundation of chocolate squares, since this seems to be inspired by s'mores, I'm going with Hershey's, followed by a few handfuls worth of pretzel sticks, and 2 full bags of marshmallows. I want enough on there that I can't see any pretzels or chocolate. Now, for this job, my normal torch, I don't think it's going to cut it, so we need to upgrade. 50,000 BTUs of propane power, I just made that number up. Get it lit and get to torching, a far less elegant process than that depicted in the cartoon, with a lot more burnt spots and a lot more miniature fires to extinguish, but we've achieved a borderline Brulee'd appearance. Turn off the torch, and then all that's left to do now is to try and eat this stupid thing. They never actually eat it in the cartoon, so the method is unknown, I'm guessing with a giant spoon? I would use graham crackers, but there's already pretzels in there, and it would be crazy to double carb, right? Anyway, this is just a bunch of half-melted marshmallows on top of pretzels, the end. I'm just kidding, let's try to make a better version. First up, let's try doing something that nobody should ever try doing, which is making your own graham crackers. First up, in a large bowl, we are combining 4.5 ounces of whole wheat flour, 4 ounces of all-purpose flour, 1.5 ounces of white granulated sugar, 1 teaspoon of salt, 1 teaspoon of baking powder, and 1 teaspoon of cinnamon. Then let's try out my new trick. Thank you. I also do really boring birthday parties and doomed weddings. Once that's tiny whisked together, we are combining in a smaller bowl 1 egg, 1.5 ounces of vegetable oil, 3 ounces of honey, and 1 ounce of milk. Fun fact, did you know that graham crackers were invented by Sylvester Graham to stop masturbation? It's true. In that spirit, we are beating together the liquid ingredients and adding them to the dry, folding together to combine with a rubber spatula until a rough, semi-firm dough forms. Don't overmix unless you want tough crackers. Then we're going to wrap this guy up in plastic wrap and refrigerate for at least 1 hour up to overnight. It's pretty soft right now and we want to get it firm enough to roll out betwixt 2 sheets of parchment paper without too much sticking. First, I'm going to divide the dough in half. We're going to do this in 2 batches. And normally you want to roll this out as thin as possible, but I'm going to go a little bit thicker to make a slightly more robust graham cracker for dipping. Once rolled out, we're going to peel off the top layer of parchment paper. If it sticks a little bit, don't worry, just pat down the rough surface with your fingers before brushing the whole thing down with a few tablespoons of milk. This is going to give our graham crackers a nice sheen that store-bought graham crackers just don't have. A joie de vivre, if you will. We're baking this guy at 300 degrees Fahrenheit for about 10 minutes before removing and cutting into our desired shapes. For this application, I'm going to cut mine into perfectly symmetrical, pristine rectangles or whatever these are, I don't care, and then place back into the oven for 15 to 20 additional minutes until deeply golden brown. We're then going to let these cool directly on the baking sheet for about 30 minutes so the residual heat continues to dry out the crackers before separating and getting down to the business of making marshmallows. First, in the bowl of a stand mixer, we're combining 1/2 cup of water and 3 packets of powdered gelatin, mixing together to make sure that everybody's nice and moistened. And then in a small saucepan, we are combining 1 1/2 cups of white granulated sugar, 1/2 cup of water, and 1 cup of light corn syrup, which we're going to take over to the stovetop and bring to the softball stage, or a temperature of 240 degrees Fahrenheit. It's going to stall at 225 for about 10 minutes while the water evaporates. Just keep the heat on and believe in yourself. Then with all the caution of an expert smelter, we're going to slowly stream the syrup down the side of the bowl while the mixer runs. Now it's at this point that you're going to realize that you should be using your wire whisk. So you're going to swap that out and slowly increase the speed to high, beating for about 5 minutes or until tripled in volume and resembling marshmallow fluff, because that's kind of what it is. And at this point, we're going to beat in 2 teaspoons of vanilla extract, mixing on medium for about 30 more seconds or until completely combined. Now for our first crack at gourmet Teddy Brulee, I'm thinking we lay down a layer of crushed graham crackers, perhaps in an effort to make cleanup a little bit easier down the line. And then I'm going to stick with milk chocolate, but why don't we go with something a little bit more luxurious? I've got some Lindt here, about 4 bars worth, that I'm going to top with our marshmallow mixture. Smooth it out and let it set at room temperature for at least 4 hours. Time for another fun fact. Did you know that marshmallows were invented by Teddy Roosevelt? That one's not true. I made that up. Anyway, after 4 hours, our marshmallows are set and we're placing them in a 400 degree Fahrenheit oven for about 10 minutes until this happens. At this point, I tried to Teddy Brulee it up a little bit, but oop. Kind of ruined it a little bit there, but that's okay. Why don't we go ahead and turn this off? and give this thing a try. And the first thing that I discovered is that the uppermost crust is near impenetrable. Most s'mores dip that you find on the internet is composed of store-bought marshmallows, and I can tell why. They create nooks and crevices into which your graham crackers can be dipped. Let's try our more robust homemade ones. Oh yeah, these are designed to punch through hardened marshmallow crusts, which is a sentence I didn't really ever think I'd say. Anyway, if you saw last week's episode, you know that I'm on a diet right now, so here is my proxy taste tester, Vinny, who gave it one enthusiastic, if a bit sticky, thumbs up. But I feel like we can still do a whole lot better, so why don't we try actually forming our marshmallows into marshmallows? First, we're going to lightly coat with vegetable oil and line with parchment paper a 9x13 casserole. Once everyone's all oiled up, we are going to dust the whole affair down with powdered sugar. Make sure that every surface is evenly coated and tap off any excess. Then we gotta make ourselves another batch of marshmallow batter? Is that what you call this stuff? I don't know. Leave a comment about the marshmallow names. And then, as before, we are letting this set uncovered for 4 hours. When we're ready to dice these guys up, we're going to liberally coat our work surface with powdered sugar, turn out the giant marshmallow, lightly oil and dust with powdered sugar a long, sharp knife, and dissect to our desired specifications. I'm going for about 1-inch cubes, which should leave plenty of nooks and crannies in our dip. And look at that, a homemade marshmallow. So much better than the store-bought stuff, and I'm just kidding, it's actually exactly the same. One thing we most certainly can upgrade is the chocolate. Milk chocolate's a little bit boring, so I'm going for a mix of 63 to 85% Gotard and Schaffenberger chocolate. And to ensure that it all melts, I'm going to preheat our skillet in the 400 degree Fahrenheit oven for about 5 minutes before dumping in the chocolate. Then, of course, atop the chocolate goes our marshmallows. Again, feel free to use the store-bought stuff. I can't really recommend this unless you're going for special flavors or colors. Into the oven it goes for 7 to 10 minutes, rotating once during cooking, et voila, Teddy brûlé. After all those attempts, I'm going to allow myself one bite, and I gotta say, the dark chocolate is a massive improvement. Uh-oh, marshmallow in the beard situation. But something you might not know about me is that I'm one of those monsters that likes his marshmallows burnt, and you know what they say? Some men, Master Wayne, just want to watch the world burn. Yes, I've been wanting to do that impression for a while. Hey guys, so I just want to talk a little bit about today's sponsor, Skillshare, an online learning community for creators. As I mentioned, I learned how to make today's marshmallows from a Skillshare class. Premium membership gives you unlimited access so you can join the classes and communities that are just right for you. Join more than 7 million creators learning with Skillshare. The first 500 viewers to use the link in this video's description will get a 2-month free trial. Whether you want to fuel your curiosity, creativity, or even career, Skillshare is the perfect place to keep you learning and thriving.